Syngenta Crop Protection Canada and CNM Seeds present the Wheat Scoop on realagriculture.com.
Okay, Pete, starter fertilizer in the fall. Myth? You can see, or real?
Myth, give your head a shake. Starter fertilizer on wheat, I've done work on starter fertilizer on wheat since 1988. It's really kind of interesting. If you go way back to when they first built seed drills, and my dad was very, very proud and just in 1948, he became a member of the 50 Bushel Club in winter wheat production. And like that was amazing back then, right? 1948, 50 bushel winter wheat. We've come a long way. But one of the ways they did that was every drill had a fertilizer box on it. And it was just automatic because even back then, they had learned how much more efficient the fertilizer was right with the seed versus just broadcasting it all over the soil surface. So why did we go away from it? Because when I started in 1988, I actually started it with this question at a field day at the Centralia Research Station. And every group of farmers that came through, I polled, how many farmers have fertilizer capability on the drill? And at that point in time, it was less than 10% of the growers that had fertilizer capability on the drill. That's how much it had dropped off since 1972 or 75, whenever, when we started to go to convenience. Everybody wanted big and fast, and the ability to do it right seemed to matter less than the ability to do it fast. So let's look at what the ability to do it right really means. And seed place starter fertilizer, since 88, we've seen all, you know, year after year after year of data. On average, my data set is 7.5 bushel per acre yield increase. And that's really significant. There's other things though that we don't realize or we don't talk about. So this past year, I'm back doing that information again, which you'd say since 88, why would you do that? Well, we're looking at low rates. I'll talk about that in a minute. And we're looking at new blends, things like the micro essentials sulfur zinc, because do we need sulfur? Do we need zinc on the wheat crop? So that's why we're doing it. But of course, we always put in strips with no starter. And in several of my locations this year, if the whole field had have had no starter fertilizer, you would have ripped it up in the spring because the winter survival was that poor that it just wasn't worth keeping. And the rest of the field with starter fertilizer, the stand was essentially perfect. So we increased the winter survival. We also increased the crop uniformity. So when the crop heads out, in Ontario right now, if you're not using a fusarium fungicide, then you're not in the game of wheat production. We're up in nitrogen rates, and in order to make use of the nitrogen, we need that fusarium fungicide. We can't tolerate fusarium. Those are two things that are just a given. Well, to do the right job with a fusarium fungicide, you have to hit the perfect timing. And if you don't use starter fertilizer and you have this really variable heading date, then you can't do a good job with the fusarium fungicide. And it's not just me that's talking about that. I have some really great crop consultants that I work with. Chad Anderson down in the heavy clays of Niagara, Lambton County, he would say, do not plant wheat without starter fertilizer, because on our heavy clays it won't survive and it will be just all a dog's breakfast at heading. Al McCollum, a crop consultant in Elgin, same thing. So there's lots of producers and lots of consultants out there that have seen this benefit. So it's absolutely real, it's there. Now let's back up a step and say, okay, so you said you were back looking at lower rates. Fertilizer is going to go to $800 a ton this fall, maybe more by next spring. So how much do I need to get the bang for the buck? Well, a couple of quick notes. First, on the fertilizer cost, if you're getting $7 a bushel for wheat, $800 phosphorus is really cheap phosphorus. It's much cheaper phosphorus than $600 phosphorus when wheat is $4. So let's get over that. And second, let's look at the data. Pretty intrigued. So in our liquid data set, so we're doing three things. We're doing zero, we're doing broadcast, we're doing three different rates of liquid, and we're doing different dry products at different rates as well. If you look at our rates of liquid, one of the things we've really learned, and we showed this with some boards that we drove over with, 2.5 gallons of liquid, you might as well not bother applying anything because it's just like a zero. And the problem is not that you're not putting some phosphorus on, the problem is you're getting a drop here and a drop here, and you've got a whole bunch of seeds in between with no phosphorus. So that doesn't work. Would it work if I took 2.5 gallons of liquid and I blended it with 7.5 gallons of water to put on 10 gallons to get a more consistent distribution? I don't know. We haven't done that work. We can't do everything. What I will tell you is that, you know, 5 gallons of liquid is okay, but 10 gallons of liquid, when we go actually to a 10-gallon rate, it does a pretty nice job. So liquid fertilizer is good fertilizer. It's convenient, but it's expensive. And to go to 10 gallons would choke a horse. So at least if you're going to run 5 gallons, our data would suggest you might do better running 5 gallons of liquid with 5 gallons of water and getting more uniform distribution in the trench. But that's something we haven't really verified, just kind of looks that way. And it's kind of cool to think about how that works. The other interesting thing is we've looked at the different products. I will say that on 1 year's data, it looks like the addition of the sulfur and zinc in the MESZ product really doesn't do much on winter wheat production. On spring wheat production, we're not sure yet, but sulfur in the fall looks like it disappears over the winter and doesn't bring something to the table for the winter wheat crop. So that's one thing. The other thing is that is 50 pounds of a MAP type product good? The answer is absolutely. Is 100 pounds better? The answer is yes. So when you're looking at that rate, I think it depends a lot on what your capability is. And I think that's the next thing that probably we need to address is, well, why did growers go away from starter fertilizer with wheat seed? And how can we get back there? Well, it really was an equipment issue. Fertilizer rusts out drills. And I can remember with that old International 10 drill that my dad had when I was growing up, every spring or every fall you had to get the pipe wrench out on the fertilizer drive and work it back and forth with the penetrating oil till it would move. And guys hate that. So how do we get around that and how do we go back to that? Because we really need to get back there. Well, you know, the simple answer is an air cart. Absolutely. An air cart with a split box. Once you have that, they're plastic, nothing rusts, and now I can do everything I want to do. I can blend my fertilizer, I can put on a reasonable amount, I can put 100 pounds per acre of MAP with my wheat seed and get the best of both worlds, cheap fertilizer, excellent response, all those good benefits. So that's a simple solution. Do we need potash? I mean, I often get asked the question, do we need potash on wheat in the fall? And based again on just 2 years' data, we would say that potash on wheat is less important than potash on corn and soybeans. So if I'm going to add potash, I'm probably going to add a small proportion of potash. So something like a 9-41-10 blend. I'm not saying zero because I think there's always a bit of an insurance policy with some potash, but not a big deal. I like 100 pounds, and so whether it's a 9-41-10 or it's 11-52-0, 100 pounds per acre is a good deal. If you don't have an air cart, and I have a single box drill, whether it's a John Deere 750 or a Great Plains or a Sunflower or whatever the drill is, one of the ways you can actually do it is blend the two together. And there's different guys have tried different ways, but you run the wheat seed up an auger into the drill and you can add some phosphorus at the bottom while you're doing that. I've seen guys pail it in and actually blend it up the auger. You can take it to the fertilizer dealer. All those things, they sound great and they work. They absolutely do work, but they're a pain in the butt, right? They're an absolute pain in the butt. The easy answer on some of these box drills with a single box drill, in my opinion, is buy yourself a little air unit and mount it on the drill. And once you have it, it's no different than buying a liquid kit and mounting the liquid kit on the drill. And will the dry fertilizer air unit cost you a little more than the liquid kit? The answer is yes, but then you will pay a little bit less for the fertilizer that you put through the thing, and it will last just as well, and it's, you know, so there's a whole bunch of trade-offs there, but it's a simple way to get back in the game and not rust your drill out. So I think there's just a whole bunch of benefits there. I think it's a simple thing to do. We have people you can talk to that have done that will support that and you know, are really sold on it. And it's kind of funny because some of the guys I work with, you know, one of the problems with air carts is that you can, air carts monitor seed flow, but the fertilizer can run out and the seed's still going down. And so now we have this test strip that we didn't mean to have. And it drives some of those consultants nuts because they would say, and every year, I mean, this year it was 15 bushels. If you didn't have the starter fertilizer there, 15 bushels less wheat. And their answer is, if you run out of fertilizer, park it until you get more fertilizer. That's how important it is.